Hello my friends and welcome again to my video channel. Today we are talking about this analog scope from Philips PM3219. It's a 50 MHz two channel analog scope. Two channels, two time bases with delay and other features, and an analog storage CRT. It has not a digital storage as today. It's a good old analog storage screen here. I acquired it on an internet platform for a few euros. The seller told me that he cannot test the instrument, so he sold it as is. And I know what this means. It means there is at minimum one defect component in it, maybe more than one component. My first test was to connect the scope to the mains, 230 volt, and to increase the voltage slowly with a small transformer from zero starting 50, 100 volts and so on, as it is done usually. And when I reached some voltage, I estimated about half the nominal value, I suddenly heard a big bang in it, inside the scope. Smoke came out of it. Okay, I shut down suddenly. The primary fuse is still okay. No problem, so the fault seems to be on the secondary side of the main transformer or anywhere else in this equipment here. I have to open it and have a look at it, and then I will see. To remove the cover of the scope here, it is sufficient to loosen these two coin screws here. Not necessary to remove these four screws here. It's sufficient to open these coin screws here. They're a little bit hard, a little bit tight, but with a big screwdriver it is not so difficult. And then it is written shifted a little bit right, and then it goes out. There are some fixing here which grab under this profile here. So the back side here is held only by these two screws here, and these two shifts here. Okay, now we are on the back side here and have to loosen according to the manual. It's always a good idea to look into the manual for this purpose. The four screws to fix the aluminium. These are the four screws here. I will remove them. After removing the four screws, I can remove this frame here. Take it away. By the way, it's always a good idea to have some wood here to protect the faceplate here, and some styrofoam to avoid damage to the knobs and the BNC contacts and so on. Have a secure stand here. So now it's off, and then we can take out the remove the instrument cover by lifting it off from the instrument. Ah, okay, that's it. I think I should first totally remove the frame here. There comes some smell out of this part here where the transformer is. It smells a little bit burnt. Maybe there's a location of the flashover we had during the initial switch on. Necessary to remove. I think I have to remove the handle here. Standing on the particular cover flat, slicking the cover. Ah, the rubber feet. And out of the rubber feet here. The problem is not the handle, the problem is the rubber feet here, which are inside a little bit too high. Yes, okay. Read the manual. Very easy. Many times the manual is much more clever than you are thinking about it. So, okay.
Oof. It was a long struggle. The problem are these rubber feet here, which stuck behind the plates here. It's a little bit difficult. This construction is not very good, but okay, it can be opened
anyhow.
Case is removed. The instrument is on this wooden frame here to have a better access. And the smell comes out of this part here, where the power line cord is coming, is fed into it. The switch for the voltage setting, 110 to 20 to 30 volt and so on, is where the fuse also is located. As I see, yes, it's here the fuse inside also. It's a fuse here. It's a plastic part, but to remove it, I first have to remove the switch. It's a power on switch here from the front side here. And to have it open, I have to remove it here first. Okay, and as I feared, I've broken the plastic part here, which fixes this axis here. You can see the rest of it. It's a clamp and it's old plastic, more than 30 years old. So it's always dangerous that these parts will break, but it's no other possibility. But now I can shift the axis here. I have to make it new with a metal one. It's not so difficult. Now I can take out the axis here and the other. I'll leave it here, it's okay. Okay, my friends, to have a better access to this switching unit here, it's necessary to remove this back plate here. And so these screws here have to be loosened. There are also one or two screws on top and back here on the bottom side here. There's two screws, so I can remove this part here, and then I have better access to this part where I assume that there is a fault here. So I will start removing the screws. After some minutes of struggle with the chassis and some fixed shoes and so on, the backplane here is removed. And I have access to the point where I wanted it. Here, remember, is a switch for the voltage range. And on the other side of the paper, let's go here to this side. You will see here a spot, and the spot is caused by this capacitor here. Okay, go away. And this capacitor is, as you can see, broken. This is a filter cap here on the main side of the 230 volt supply here. It looks very ugly in the schematic. I hope you can see it. Let's switch this off here. Mains here is coming in. And this is the filter cap here, which is broken. I don't understand why this fuse isn't blown. The fuse is okay. I've checked it, but maybe the current was too weak. And it's a slow blow fuse. It's a tongue twister, slow blow fuse. So maybe the fuse was slower than the capacitor here. And so the fuse survived. Okay, I will have to exchange this capacitor and then look for the next problem. And now here we can see the reason why this capacitor failed. This capacitor here is specified for 250 volt AC. 250 volt AC is definitely too weak. Here we have 230 volt AC nominal. And in this urban region where I'm living, the voltage is sometimes 235 or so. So this capacitor is a point where a failure has to appear over the time.
especially after 30 years of operation of such a capacitor. So it is definitely a wrong dimensioned component. I will exchange it. I will take it, replace it with a capacitor which has only 150 nanofarads. Sorry, which is only 150 nanofarads. You see here it, but it has a voltage of 630 volt DC. 630 volt DC is equal to a voltage of 440 volt AC. 440 volt AC is of course much better than we have here, the 250 volts. So I think this will make no problems in the future. And the difference between 220 and 150 nanofarads, I think it can be neglected and it's not essential.
Okay, as you can see here, the new capacitor is installed. It's a green one capacitor in the middle of the picture. The paper inside is cleaned, so all metal parts are removed and cannot be cause any shorts in the future, which could happen when they start moving around in the equipment. So it's better to remove them completely. Okay, next step is to optically check the capacitors here, for example. But I've seen they are all okay, so I don't start recapping it here. I will see what happens when I switch it on again and then go to the next step. If there's another problem. I'm not a friend of removing all electrolytic caps. I think it's not necessary. Sorry, it's not necessary here because they look all good. They have no leak optical. I cannot detect any leakages and so on. So I leave them and wait what happens when I switch it on. After some work, some difficult work, the plane here, back plane here is again in its place as it should be. The paper here is back again. And for the broken connection here, you remember this part here, this little piece was broken. I simply installed here a piece of wire, which is also good. It simply bring it through it, through the hole, bend it back on both sides, so it does the same job as the original piece of plastic. After successful of the repair of the capacitor, of the exchange of the capacitor, I connected the instrument to the power supply, started it up, and connected one of the channels to the calibrator here. This calibrator supplies 1.2 volt here, not 1.0, 1.2 volt. And I'm trying to synchronize it, to trigger it correctly. And as you see, it's not possible. It's indication here, the indication that it is triggered, but it runs here. So something is rotten in the trigger. But that's not the main problem in the moment for me. I hear something, I hear a very small hiss. It's an indication that something in the high voltage area is not okay. And I have a little smell of ozone, O3, in my nose. So that shows me that there is some arcing and so on anywhere in the high voltage part here. I don't know where it is exactly. It is still triggered. I assume that this is the reason for the shifting image here. So the time-based cannot trigger. When we increase the setting here, you see it is not a straight line as it should be. There's a ripple on it. It indicates that we have a problem anywhere in the power supply or with the high voltage transformer and so on. It is a switched power supply internally. The supply from the line is switched and not rectified as in the standard configuration. It is a switched power supply, so maybe there is a problem. That's what I hear hissing. I have to look on the back side where it is and see what happens. And now how to locate the hiss, the source of the hiss. I take a plastic pipe and work like a doctor. Don't laugh about it, but it's very precise. And by poking around here, I can find the source. Here is nothing. This is the power supply board. Fortunately, here is nothing. Single source I have here. Single source here, where the hiss comes from, is this black box here. And this black box here is a high voltage cascade which produces the 7 kV. And when I wipe a little bit on it, I have a black finger here, you can see there's a lot of dust on it. Maybe I should clean it and then the hiss would go away. But this is not the main problem at the moment. I've seen a minute ago that the scope has another problem. You remember the picture was rather dark. Now the picture is has a rather high intensity and I cannot control it. I have no chance. The focus does a little bit change the picture, but the intensity control is dead, absolutely dead. Position and so on, and also the amplification, the signal itself can be seen, but this is a clear indication that maybe there's a component faulty or something in the power supply, so which could be faulty. I have to look at the power supply first. Next step is for me to look at the power supply and to clean up the high voltage cascade. My feeling is this scope here is playing a little small game with me. I just moved this high voltage cascade up. There are two clips. One clip is here and the other clip is on the other side. So it is now a little bit shifted from the chassis. It is free here. And the hiss is gone. No hiss any longer. It is not cleaned. I only just prepared to clean it and switched on again to see what happens, whether I can see any sparks or so. Andy, here between chassis and the case here, couldn't see anything, but it's clear, nothing happens, and the screen is, as you see, as before. I can focus it, move it up and down, and not as before, very bright. It is now normal. I have no problems here, but this is not normal here. Of course, there is a fault anywhere, I'm sure, because it should be a straight line. When I ground the signals here, the input, it should be a straight line, and I see here some interruptions. But the hiss is gone, so I think it's only a question of the cascade of the case outside, clean it, and then I can snap it in and can work with it again. But I have forgotten to tell a safety hint. This COT here has a voltage of 7 kV. And even when I switch off the unit here, what I'm doing now, the 7 kV are still present on the tube here. Maybe that discharge or not, but when I remove the cascade here, the 7 kV are coming from the tube here, are still present here. Such a tube is like a capacitor. If I open the connector here and take this cascade out, there is a very, very high voltage here present, which can be lethal. Or the shock is good for the rest of your life. So be very, very careful when working at high voltage part
of such a CRT. Be very careful, think about what you are doing. Don't be in a hurry, otherwise it's your last job you are doing. I will shut it down, remove it from the line supply here, and let it stay overnight here, and then tomorrow I will open the screw here and the other connections here, and then take this cascade out, clean it, also the chassis, and then I will go on. Have a good night. After identifying the source of the noise, this is a cascade here, high voltage cascade, which produces here the 7 kV output for the cathode ray tube here. I had to remove again the back plane, back side of the scope here, and remove this HV cascade. By the way, the black outside here is a graphite. It's a shield, not only dirt, it's also graphite. And I think I've identified the problem where the noise, the hiss is produced. We see here, this point, a little small black. I will make it a little bit greater, one moment. Can still see it here, yes, here, the right side of the picture, a black point where this cable comes in. This is approximately 1.5 or 2 kV AC input for the cascade. That's the ground here, and that's the output here. Here's a little black spot, and on the other side here, where the cascade is mounted here, the left side here of picture, you see also a black point here. This is a little bit not flat enough here, so I think there is a metal sheet of wire or something like this coming out, and this is causing with the time some small flashes to the chassis here, and so it is necessary here to clean it and to have a provision to make it a little bit shorter here, to cut it a little bit to avoid such flashes here. It's an ugly work because I have to go into the isolation here on this place here, but I have no better idea. I could drill a hole here in it, but drilling a hole in it here would require me to remove everything here. I don't want it. I have to look and to decide what I do, but it's a good explanation because these flashes here are outside of a component, so the ozone which I smelled is generated here in this region here, and also this region here, and this is spread over the room, and so I can smell it and I can the hiss here. It's a bad construction. There's something wrong in the factory. Maybe you're thinking the guy doesn't know the difference between left and right. I can assure you I know the difference between left and right, but in this scene I looked onto the controls screen of the camera, and I wasn't aware in this moment that the screen mirrors it. So what is left is on the screen right, and vice versa. I was concentrated on the picture and tried to focus it. So I said left and I meant right, and vice versa. But I'm quite sure you saw it. But I wanted to give you a small explanation why this happened. Just to make it clear what we are talking about here, we are talking about this high voltage cascade which produces a 7 kV, 7000 volt for the CRT, but we are talking not about the output here, we are talking about the input. It's a quadrupler here, so the input is roughly, let me say, 1.5 or 2 kV peak, and it is quadrupled here to 7 kV, and we are talking about this connection here. This connection here had a this problem here with the isolation. There was some solder here, but this solder had no more connection to any wire here, but it was sufficient to produce some flashes to the ground, to the chassis, because here it is mounted a flash on the surface on the aluminium chassis, so any bad isolation here causes a flash over here. It was outside, the flash over was outside the cascade, so it could produce ozone, and it was heard. This here is a ground connection here.
Luckily, it was very easy for me to remove this solder with a dentist tool, like you see here. As you see here, it had only contact with a gray isolation, but not with any wiring or any wires or traces or such things. It was a single soldering, and I don't know how it came in here, but it happened during the manufacturing process of this cascade. I took it out, and now there's some glue in it for new isolation, so I hope the problem is solved now. This soldering made no direct electrical contact for DC, but it had obviously a capacitive coupling to ground, and this cascade is operated with approximately 40 kilohertz, so it gave a capacitive coupling and some capacitive current, I think in the range of microamps. So it was no big current, but it was enough to make some noise and to produce some ozone or something like this. So it's good that it's out here, and I hope it's okay now. In the following sequence, I show you how I painted this cascade here with graphite. I forgotten to switch on the microphone, sorry. Operator to stupid error. But it's also self-explaining without any sound, without microphone. So it's also good for watching it only. I used some graphite spray, but I didn't use it as a spray, of course, because it would give a big problem here. I would have to isolate everything and to screen it. So I sprayed it in a small box, and then I used a mechanical way to apply it here. You see it's rather good, and it dried out very rapid within some minutes, and then I snapped it on the last side. I painted here in the original position here. Important is to have contacts here where the plastic snaps onto the aluminum frame here to have a good contact for the shielding. You will see it. Hope it helps. I'm feeling frustrated after I removed this small solder pin, which made the problems of the partial discharge. I thought it was a problem. I installed the cascade again in the scope, and the hiss was still there. No improvement, nothing was better than before. So I had again a look at the cascade and found when it is outside the scope, not installed on the aluminum chassis, when it is installed isolated, then it's all okay. It works perfect, as it should. When I install it on the chassis, flat on the chassis, there is still the hiss. So I assume there's a problem with the material who isolates it, with the resin in it. So I had a look at it, and I found it was a little bit dirty on the surface, and maybe there's also some humidity in it. Maybe it's taking water. I'm not very sure it is hygroscopic or not. Here I show you what I did. I've cut out here the hole by bottom here. It's the bottom side, top side, bottom side here of the resin here. Scratched it out with a knife here. There's a sharp ridge here from cutting off the blades, and without hurting these cables, of course, about 1 or 2 millimeters. That's the rest here. So I have a blank one, and this is very clear. The side here was rather dirty. There were bubbles in it, and some parts which were a little bit black and so on. Maybe it was also a production problem or not. I don't know exactly, But this was a problem when there's a metal flat on it. It has at once a partial discharge. If it is isolated like here, it works perfectly. So the reason is maybe this isolation here, which is not good. I scratched it off. And if there is some humidity in it, maybe I will heat it a little bit to get the water out and to have a better isolation. It's my next step to do it into an oven, to bake it at a temperature of 60-70 degrees Celsius. Not to melt the plastic, of course, but to have enough heat to get it out, to get the water and the humidity out of it. Maybe it is hygroscopic. Some years ago, I had a transceiver, an old Kenwood transceiver, TS-440, as I remember. This transceiver had a problem. The display showed only dots. The VCOs didn't lock. And the reason was an isolation material similar to this. The VCOs were sealed with this material. And the material was hygroscopic. I had to remove this material and to dry out the VCOs, and then it worked perfect, and had to a new isolation material in it. I used hot melt glue to do it. It was a good solution, I think, and since the transceiver works very well. Okay, I made it. It is now clear, and then I do it into an oven. And here you can see the cascade in my oven, roasted at 60 to 70 degrees Celsius. After many, many hours, it's a temperature at which you can still hold it in your hand for a few seconds, so it's a good indication. If it's too hot to hold it in your hand, then you have obviously a too high temperature set in the oven. I will take it out now and seal it with hot melt glue. And after sealing it with hot melt glue, it's back in the oven again to dry out. And hopefully it is now waterproof for the rest of its life. And you can see here the hot melt gun. And now the cascade is ready for installation again. I've cleaned the bottom side a little bit, cut all not needed hot melt glue away. There were some hills on it, some mountains and so on. It was not absolutely flat, but now it is flat. With a knife, it can be made flat enough so it can snap in, and we will see how it works. Let's make a first test. The scope is connected to the power outlet here. The HV cascade is in place. It's connected to the CRT. It's solidly grounded. I've measured the resistance between the housing, the new graphite, and the ground. It's some kilo ohms and so on. Now let's switch on. Okay. The lamp here burns. No explosion up to now. I'm still alive here. Okay. I can make a focus here. Looks a little bit funny. Maybe we have a problem with the power supply, I assume. But it's another topic. But in general, it works. We can make an X position here, change. Okay. Change to the channel A. There are some blanks in it. I don't know where they come from. The time here is 10 microseconds per division. So every 25 microseconds, which is 40 kilohertz, there's a blank or something like this. Let's have it here. Exposition is a little bit more than 20 microseconds. Okay, then 20 can be maybe that we have a that is 40 kilohertz here. It's related to the switching frequency of the power supply. But in general, we have a picture, that's good. When I go to channel B, I have a similar picture. It's also a little bit distorted. Let us make a rough check with the calibrator. I connect it to ground here. Okay, looks a little bit crazy. Hold off time. It's all a little bit distorted, not as I have expected when I switch it off. When I ground it, zero is ground here. Okay, I have 0.1 volt per division. It's roughly two divisions, that's 1 volt. I have here 1.2 volt for calibration purpose. It looks not so bad, but not like I've expected it. So if there is a problem in general, I think inside the power supply. So we have to, first we have to check the all supply voltages inside the scope. I didn't do it up to now because I was focused on the cascade and not on other topics here. Well, let's do it. I will check it. I have access here to these voltage levels on this socket here, on this pin row here. The supply marked, this is this row here, is this row here. So we go through it point by point. And then we will have a response. I will start with minus 180 volt. Okay, and you see it is minus 186. That's okay. Then we have plus 180 volt. 181, it's also okay. Plus 38. Next is plus 12 volt, 11.9, okay. Plus 5 volt, 509, it's also okay. You can read it here, yes. Next one is minus 12 volt, minus 10.2, not so good. And the last one is, as I see, is ground. Yes, ground is 0.00. Okay, the minus 12 volt is a little bit way off. 10.2, looks not so good. I don't understand it in the moment. Due to the schematic, we will have a look at the schematic on the computer here. It should be the same as plus 12 volt, so the difference is not obvious for me. We will have a look at it. We can see the plus and minus 12 volt are developed in this bridge rectifier here. This winding, the secondary winding of the transformer of the switched power supply, it's operated with 40 kilohertz, as I said. One winding tap here, one tap here, that's the ground. So if there's plus, it goes there, and then here we have minus, it goes there. If we have here minus, it goes here there. When we have here plus, it goes here there. So we have here always plus and minus switching, electrolytic, filter, another electrolytic. This plus 12 volt is 12 volt plus. And here we have only minus 10 volt, not minus 12 volt. I don't understand why. Because it's absolutely symmetric and there shouldn't be any problem here. Except there is a problem in one of the components here. I don't really think it's in the following circuit here. So I have to focus on this power supply here, on this rectifier circuit and on the electrolytics and so on. Maybe there's a fault inside. Or could also happen, of course, we have here a very heavy load. Then we would have a high ripple here. It has to be checked. The next step I will do is to check the purity, the ripple of these two voltages here, plus 12 and minus 12, whether they have different ripples or not, and to show or to find out whether there is any fault or not. And now I go through the power supply pins with my scope in AC mode, 20 millivolt per division. But you should take it 10 times because I have a probe with 10 attenuation factor, 10 of attenuation, so it's 200 millivolt per division. And I have AC coupling, as you can see here, the small sign here, it's AC coupling. I start at the beginning, it's ground, it's not so important. The next one is minus 12 volt, where we have the problem. Oh, there's a ripple of approximately 350 millivolt peak to peak, nearly 400 millivolt. That's a lot. Let's go to plus 5 volt. What says plus 5 volt? Nearly nothing. Okay, I think it's acceptable. It's only for the digital part. Now we go to the plus 12 volt. It's only some millivolts. 5 millivolt, 50 millivolt peak. Okay, let's go to the next one. It's a 38 volt. A little bit more. 38 volt. It's 200 millivolt or so. Then plus 180 volt. It takes a time until the scope comes down. The coupling capacitor has to charge or discharge. Okay, it's 200, 400, 600, roughly 600. Now we go to minus 180 volt. Okay, it's acceptably, the trigger is not stable, should have chosen another slope. Okay, the biggest problem is, as we see, I go back to it, is a minus 12 volt, which has a considerable ripple here. So it has a problem with a DC level, 10 point something, and a relatively high ripple on it. So we have to examine it further. What am I doing here? I've soldered here two pins, one black and one red, to the plus and minus 12 volt DC supply we have seen on the schematic, and I will feed them with these cables. Here's a ground connection to my DC power supply, connected for plus and minus 12 volt. And I will try to support the 12 volt from the power supply, from the internal power supply of the scope, with the external power supply, and see whether I have any change or not. This is possible because the rectifier diodes will suddenly not conduct when the voltage on the capacitors is higher than the driving side from the transformer. For example, if the transformer has 12 volt peak and I will give 12.5 volt on it, so the diodes cannot conduct, they are always blocked, and the complete power supply is done by the external power supply, as you can see here. That's what I will try. Next step is I connected the scope again to the main supply, switched it on, but didn't connect it to the power supply, to the external power supply. I want just to be safe, on the safe side, that I am not matching up any wires. This multimeter here is connected to ground, this should be the minus 12 volt, which is obviously not minus 12 volt as we see. And we can see this minus 10.2. Switch on this lamp here. Hope you can see it better now. Minus 10.2, so black is minus 12. And now the plus 12 volt, 11.9. Okay, I have here on these two pins, can switch it off. The voltages, plus and minus 12 volt, which are not exactly plus and minus 12 volt. First I disconnect here something to have a better access here. Can better work and not to create any problems. When you're doing such a job and have an external power supply, it should be good to adjust the external power supply to the voltage you expect, because some or not all power supplies are designed for reverse voltage coming in. For example, if the output voltage is set to zero, and if you have a linear regulated power supply, so the output transistors may be damaged when they suddenly get a high voltage in the reverse direction. So I've set it to the minus voltage to minus 10 volt as it is. Now I connect it, minus 10.2, looks a little bit better. I increase it to 10, 11, volt external power supply. The current is 0.28 milliamps. And now I do the same procedure with the plus 12 volt. I connect it here to the plus 12 volt. Increase it also a little bit until it takes current here. Oh, interesting. Okay, I am into 20 millivolt range now. Something triggered, but it's much, much smaller, the noise, than before. Yes, it means for me that power supply is the next problem we have. I have to check the capacitors, the rectifier diodes, and here you can see I've removed the power supply board on the back side of the scope here, and took it on my workbench here for further examination, especially the capacitors and diodes and so on, and I have a better access to it. The four diodes of the 12 volt rectifiers are out, and now I will measure them. My scope here has a nice feature. It has the option to operate also as a component tester. This is normal scope operation, and now we have the component tester. The screen here is plus minus 10 volt, and in vertical it is plus minus 10 milliamps, and the frequency is about 50 hertz. A short circuit here makes a vertical line, of course. Open, it's a horizontal line, it's only voltage, no current. And if I make a short circuit, I have only current, but obviously no voltage. This is good for checking diodes, resistors. I think 1 kilo ohm should be 45 degrees or something like this. And diodes can be tested rather easily here with this mode. So it's a little bit better than only a check with an ohm meter as a go, non-go test. We can see a little bit more because it goes up to 10 volt in both directions, and we see whether the diode is really switching as a diode or whether there are also other problems in it.
Let's go to the first diode. Difficult to contact, but it looks good. Second diode. Looks also good. Sorry, it was. Yes. Third diode. Also okay. And the fourth diode. Also okay.
The first capacitors I've soldered out are the capacitors for the plus minus 12 volt rails for the filtering, and I will check it with my capacitance tester. This should have a capacity of 220 microfarads. I can measure at 120 hertz. Let us see what happens. And the measurement says 115 microfarad at 120 hertz. Should have 220. When I switch to 1 kilohertz, I have only 37 microfarad. That's not good. Because we have an operating frequency of 40 kilohertz and not 1 kilohertz. It's obvious that the capacity drops with increasing frequency due to the inductivity of the capacitor. But such extreme 120 hertz I have now is nearly DC, and 115 microfarad instead of 220 is not acceptable. But this capacitor is definitely not okay. I use the second one here, the big ones, which are on the side of the diodes. Sorry, it's a little difficult here. Measurement says, is it true? 700 nanofarads? 785 nanofarads. It's nano, not micro. Nanofarad. It's less than 1 microfarad at 120 hertz. At 1 kilohertz, 80 nanofarad. Do I have a problem with the contacts here? No, can't believe. It's okay here. 800 nanofarads at 120 hertz. Oh, it's getting worse. Let's check the smaller ones here. Should have, let me say, 47, I think. 68 microfarads. 68 microfarads. At 120 hertz. 63, and they have 23. No discussion. And the last one here. A little bit tweaking here to make a better contact here. Also 27 microfarad. And at 1 kilohertz, 4.8 microfarad. Well, that's not good. It's clear indications that the capacitors are dried out. They are not leaking. It's obvious that they can't leak when they are dried out. There's nothing inside to leak. So they have to go. And I'm quite sure that the other blue capacitors here inside this power supply board are also bad. I have to exchange all blue capacitors here in this power supply. All electrolytic caps are now out of the power supply unit. The result of measuring the capacity was partially cruel, very cruel. The first capacitor under test is the big cap here. It has 6800 microfarad at 40 volt, and it is connected behind the rectifier, 24 volt, 40 hertz, 50 hertz, 24 volt, 50 hertz. It provides the power for the switching power supply here. First step is I measure the DC resistance. I have here the voltmeter connected to my power supply here, 38 volt, a little bit lower than the specified 40 volt. And I'm measuring here the flowing DC current. Full scale is 10 microamps. I have a very sensitive microampere meter. So we have a current of 2 or 3 microamps here. Sometimes it is very partially negative. I assume that there's some noise also on the power supply, which is also not absolutely correct and stable. You see it here, the voltage is a little bit drifting on the third point behind the decimal. So I don't know what the reason is for the flickering here. But in general, a value of some microamps is very good for such a big cap. The cap is rather old, but it is, seems to be still good. And I will measure the capacitance. That this will be the next step, and also capacitance of some of these to demonstrate how bad they are. There are only 3 or 4 caps of them which are within tolerance. The rest of them are clearly out of tolerance and need to be replaced. And here is a small hint. After a measurement of such big capacitors, it's necessary to discharge them, but please not with a screwdriver over the contacts, over the poles. This would create a very, very big high current and a big bang. Use a resistor to discharge it. Here I have 20 kilo ohms, some watts here. This one is connected to the pins here of the capacitor. It takes, of course, some minutes with a big capacity and this rather high resistor. But it is then guaranteed that the capacitor is completely discharged and does not make any problems. Otherwise, as I told you, we will get a maybe also some damage on your equipment that is not necessary. Meanwhile, the big capacitor is discharged, connected it to the LCR meter. Capacity is 6.3 millifarad, that means 6,300 microfarad. Quality factor is 4, that's not so high, but I think it's enough. Measured at 120 Hertz, when I go to 1 kilohertz, it still has 1,650 microfarad. In series mode measured, this is parallel mode here, when I measure this capacity in serial mode, then we come to a capacity of 6.67, that's very close to the specified 6,800 microfarad. So the DC current is very, very low in the microamps region. Capacity, measured capacity is okay, so I think this capacitor here can still be used. It can go into place again and has not to be replaced. It's okay for further use. Now I show you some examples of the measured capacitors of the others. I have soldered out here because they are all very bad. This one I haven't selected. It has 220 microfarad. 220. And the measured capacity is 116. It's one of the better ones, but it's way off specification. So it has to go. The next one is 4.7 microfarad. 4.7 microfarad. And it actually has 5.9. That's okay here. It's one of the good ones here. Let's do it in the box here, but I will not use it. 470 microfarad again. And measured is 147, only a third at 120 Hertz, so cannot be accepted, for example, to show it at 1 kilohertz. There's only 40 microfarads. Should have 470. And in serial mode, to be a little bit better, it has 170, but it should have 470. So it is also not okay. And so goes it on. Let's use one of the smaller ones here. This is 33 microfarad here. As an example here, I don't know if it's one of the good ones. I think not. 33 should have. 19 has, okay. but it's also way of specification, makes no sense to use it any longer. And so it goes on. Here we have 47 microfarad again, and I will check it, 47, and it has 52. Theoretically we could use it, it's a good one. 220 microfarad here. one microfarad. It should have, is it true? Yes, 220 microfarads, 16 volt. It has 1 microfarad. It's serial mode overload, so cannot be measured reasonably, and at 1 kilohertz, 107 nanofarad. Okay, this is one of the very bad guys, and so on. So most of these capacitors are bad. I think one or two others are also within range, but I will simply throw them away and replace them by other ones. Meanwhile, I've ordered new capacitors here. They're also blue, as you see, but this is a different brand. For example, this is, what is the capacity here? What does it stand? Can't I read it? So we're going to have to look on the table. It has to be 470 microfarad. 471. Ah, here is it. Where is it? 470 microfarad. Plus, minus. 475, 77. And at 1 kilohertz, it still has 275 microfarad. It's millifarad here. And the quality factor at 100 hertz, 6, 7. And the serial mode, when I switch to the serial mode here, it's 487. So these new capacitors are okay. I will check them all before I solder them in, but there's a new ones here I've ordered. Seem to be okay, so I can continue with my work.